Welcome to Balancing the Ledger, where finance and tech intersect. I'm Jen Vietchner.
I'm Jeff Roberts.
And today we're joined by Chris Burniske, a partner at venture capital firm Placeholder and co-author of the new book, Cryptoassets. Thank you so much for being here, Chris.
Thanks for having me.
So we have to talk about Goldman Sachs getting into cryptocurrency. They've confirmed now officially that they are opening a Bitcoin trading operation to trade Bitcoin futures and other derivatives, not actual Bitcoin yet, but they say maybe that's coming. This is a big Wall Street institution getting into Bitcoin. Chris, is this a big turning point for the industry?
I think this is more signaling of Bitcoin's legitimacy. Goldman has built a reputation for itself, certainly, over the decades, and especially as a technology-first investment bank. And so the fact that they are venturing into this new technology, this new asset class, is just indicative of what's to come, I think, from other financial institutions.
But Chris, on a practical level, some people are pointing out they're simply creating a derivatives product to help clients trade futures. So presumably this will not introduce a whole bunch more liquidity or have any kind of immediate effect on pricing?
Yeah, I believe it's a non-deliverable forward. And it's Goldman's way, at least I see it as Goldman's way of wading into the space. They're not going directly to trying to custody physical Bitcoin. They're not exposing themselves, say, directly to crypto exchange risk. They're working securitized puzzle pieces, so to speak, that fit into their existing financial infrastructure while still offering their clients more direct access to Bitcoin.
But if I understand correctly, I mean, a lot of the price rise that we've seen so far in Bitcoin has actually largely been driven by individual investors, retail investors. And so now to have this institutional money coming in, does that mean, you know, is this going to be the next leg up for the industry?
I think institutionals are important, and there are a few questions that remain. Certainly right now, there's a regulatory overhang, right? People are holding their breath to see what ball drops next with the SEC and CFTC. There's also concerns around custody, because as we just brought up, Goldman is not directly handling Bitcoin itself. Tax ramifications, especially as you get deeper into some of the crypto asset realm, like staking, how do you tax those things? So there are, as of yet, unanswered questions that as those are answered, you will have more and more financial institutions coming on board with examples like Goldman as the earliest indicators.
The other big news this week, too, was this firm called Andra Capital. They've raised $500 million for a tokenized venture capital firm. Their target, I guess, eventually is $1 billion. So basically, it's a cryptocurrency to allow people to invest in a venture firm and then venture capital backed firms.
And the name, Silicon Valley Coin. I mean, come on.
Exactly.
It's a big raise. I don't think of this as a crypto asset, though. I think of this as tokenized ownership in a venture capital fund. And I think we're going to see a lot more of this tokenization of existing asset classes, just as I think it was 2004 when we had our first gold ETF exchange-traded fund. And that is just adding existing asset classes that have existing well-known value drivers, but adding them to new world wrappers. And so it's interesting, but I see it as incremental innovation as opposed to disruptive innovation.
And speaking of venture capital, you've recently started Placeholder, which is your VC firm. Tell us a little bit about your philosophy for the firm and what you're looking for.
Sure. So Placeholder is a venture capital firm that invests in decentralized information networks incentivized with a crypto asset. And so what that means is, although we are a venture capital firm, we are not focused on equity as an asset class. We are focused on crypto assets as an asset class, or what people commonly refer to also as tokens. Our North Star is the developers. The reason we chose to do a venture capital firm versus a hedge fund is to create a 10-year cocoon of capital, say. Since it is a 10-year committed capital fund, our relationship with our investors, our understanding with our investors, is that we're not legally obligated to return the money prior to 10 years from now. Of course, we can return it more quickly should that happen. But what this allows us to do is ignore Mr. Market and really focus on the developers and engineers and the projects that we support and going to work for these networks. Some of our LPs include Morgan Stanley, Invesco, Aberdeen Standard, of course, USV, Foundry Group. So these are household names, say, that are interested in crypto, have waded into crypto, and are further exploring the scene.
Some of this seems familiar ground. We have traditional limited partners. We have something that looks a lot like a VC. However, the part I can't get my head around is what's an exit going to look like? In traditional VCs, after 7 years, the company might go public or gets acquired and then distribute the cash to the limited partners. How is that going to happen 7 or 10 years from now on the crypto front?
Well, the interesting thing is we get to choose when we exit. And that is very different from a traditional VC that focuses on early stage equity. Our thinking is we are a liquidity provider when things crash. We build our position slowly but with conviction over time. And then either when the thesis has played out or we've lost our conviction in a team, or maybe the whole market is irrationally exuberant and everything's up 10x market wide and we decide to wind down the fund, that's when we will exit. There are ways potentially, again, because these assets are liquid and it depends what happens with placeholder, where we can exit without selling. And that would actually be transferring it to a separate vehicle. Our LPs can then choose, well, do we want to just continue to hold this? There's a lot of flexibility and we just don't know yet.
In your book, Cryptoassets, you've actually laid out a model for valuing some of these crypto assets. I mean, a lot of people think Bitcoin just trades on whatever the headlines are, you know, or whatever the hype is, what people are saying on Twitter. But you've said that actually there might be some more fundamentals underpinning all of this.
Mm-hmm. Part of the thinking with crypto assets is they're not businesses, right? And they don't have business models. They don't have profits. They are really single or multi-good economies that deal in these digital services. So what I end up doing is I use an equation known as the equation of exchange, which is MV equals PQ, where on the left side of the equation, you have M, which is the size of a monetary base, multiplied by V, which is the velocity of that money, the number of times it turns over in a year. So if you take, say, the US dollar monetary base of roughly 4 trillion right now, velocity of roughly 5, that equals 20. On the right-hand side of the equation, you have PQ. P is the average price of a basket of goods offered by that economy, and Q is the quantity of goods. And together, that represents the size of the economy. So again, for the US, that's 18 trillion, but approaching 20 trillion. And so those two sides need to match. What I end up doing, which is a little unorthodox, is I solve for the necessary monetary base of a crypto asset to provision an economy of size PQ at velocity V. And so that requires me setting up models that actually look somewhat like a DCF if you were to just look at them from 30,000 feet in terms of each year I'm projecting out the price of the basket of goods, say it could be file storage or transcoding or bandwidth or whatever it may be, the quantity of that good to give me a dollar size of that economy divided by a velocity of the crypto asset to let me know, okay, in that year, what does the monetary base need to be to support
that? How would this metric
economy
work in sort of a pure currency for like a Bitcoin or a Litecoin? Does it apply equally? I'm just trying to envision the basket of goods in that case.
It does apply. It's a little bit more fuzzy, say conceptually, in terms of the good or service is actually a currency, money over internet protocol. But you can use different examples to break it down. If we were to take remittances, say, remittances globally, I think is roughly $500 billion. And if we say, okay, of that flow, Bitcoin will provision 10%, that means there will be a flow of $50 billion using Bitcoin's blockchain. So really the economy of Bitcoin moving money as a service. And then if I say, okay, Bitcoin's velocity is going to be 10, I divide that 50 billion by 10 to get a monetary base of size 5 billion specific to that use case. But then I can do it for gold, I can do it for business to business payments, I can do it for all kinds of things and stack these use cases to get a network value for these assets.
In the last year, the end of last year, people were talking about, well, you know, Bitcoin is in a bubble, it was approaching $20,000, now we're a little bit under 10,000. How do things look, you know, through that lens, you know, of the network value mm-hmm. and the valuation metrics compared to where we were?
Sure. The idea of a crypto PE ratio brings us into the relative valuation side, which can be instructive for where we are currently. And so the most common ratio used right now is called the network value to transactions ratio, where you have network value, which is really the number of coins outstanding multiplied by the price, divided by the on-chain transaction value. And the reason we use the on-chain transaction value there is that's really the utility of a crypto network, again, supporting this economy of size PQ, just as the utility of a company is to create profits that benefit the shareholders. And so if you look at this ratio, this NVT ratio, we were getting into bubble territory at the end of 2017. And so that was an indicator that things might be overheating, that the market is valuing Bitcoin's network value at a richer valuation than it historically has given the transaction value. And we corrected, and we're right now, at least the last time I checked, in a historical norm situation.
Norm, so we're about average, not relatively undervalued or overvalued?
Around there.
Around there. Okay, so there's no clear signal whether it's a good time to buy or not.
Well, if you take, say, the average of the NVT ratio over time, and it, again, it depends exactly how you calculate the numerator, how you calculate the denominator, it's somewhere in the 80s. So you can use that as a historical baseline. I don't know, again, placeholder now being a venture capital firm, I don't focus on the day-to-day of the markets like I used to at ARK Invest. But the last time I pulled these numbers, it was just below that historical norm, which would say, okay, it's a little undervalued. But I would caution people of reading into these indicators too much. It's still very early days for crypto. We have just about a decade of data, actually really less, because markets really only started to come online and be robust with Mt. Gox robust. And so we need more data, we need more historical norms, and I think a lot of the theory will conform to the fact. As these network values persist, as transaction values grow, we will just see these patterns and these ranges that these relative valuations fall into.
That's all we have time for today. Thank you so much, Chris, for being here.
Thanks for having me.
I'm Jen Vietchner.
I'm Jeff Roberts.
And for more Balancing the Ledger, please come to fortune.com. We'll see you next time.